It was one of the most expensive engineering projects ever. A double-decker bridge over 8 miles long, with 10 lanes of traffic connecting two bustling cities in California's Bay Area. Then, a devastating earthquake, and a reconstruction project of more than 10 years and $6.5 billion in the making. How did California replace its longest bridge span, one that 280,000 people drive on every single day, without bringing an entire city to a standstill? The story of Bay Bridge has it all. Emperors, earthquakes, the US Navy, SEALs, the FBI, and even Arnold Schwarzenegger. But the way the bridge was removed and replaced, that's even more unbelievable. So stick around. It's a story you'll definitely want to hear. Now, when people think of San Francisco bridges, the iconic Golden Gate Bridge is the one that usually comes to mind. But there's another bridge in town, the San Francisco-Oakland Bay Bridge, better known as the Bay Bridge. Stretching 8 miles, this double-decked giant connects San Francisco to Oakland, and it's a crucial part of Interstate 80. It's one of the widest bridges in the world, with 10 lanes to prove it. But despite all that, it still lives in the shadow of its more famous sibling. But we're about to give it the spotlight it deserves. The dream of a bridge connecting San Francisco with Oakland, Berkeley, and Alameda began as early as 1850, when newspaper editor William Walker proposed a causeway similar to the 1800-foot Clay Street Wharf. Fast forward to the Gold Rush days, and the idea of a bridge connecting the areas gained traction due to San Francisco's worries about its trade future after the Transcontinental Railroad connected Oakland to the rest of the country in 1869. By 1872, the whimsical Emperor Joshua Norton, a San Francisco resident who had earlier declared himself Emperor of the United States, decreed that a bridge be built. He famously stated, "We do hereby command the arrest by the army of both the boards of city fathers if they persist in neglecting our decrees." What he lacked in actual civic power, he made up for in vision. However, it wasn't until the 1920s, with the rise of automobiles, that the Bay Bridge project finally gained momentum. In 1929, the California legislature got serious about making it happen and created the California Toll Bridge Authority, which took action on earlier bridge proposals. Construction kicked off in July of 1933, and in just 3 years and 5 months, the bridge was completed. It opened in November of 1936, just 6 months before its more famous neighbor, the Golden Gate Bridge. On opening day, former President Herbert Hoover issued the bold proclamation, "This is the greatest bridge yet constructed in the world." The total cost of the 3-year project? A staggering $77 million. Wait, $77 million and 3 years? What happened to the 10-year, $6.5 billion figures we mentioned at the beginning of this video? Well, there's a simple explanation. The bridge isn't the same one that opened in 1936. And an earthquake is responsible for that. On October 17, 1989, at exactly 5:04 p.m., the Loma Prieta earthquake struck with a vengeance, rattling the Bay Area with a magnitude of 6.9. It killed 63 people and injured over 3,700. Over 80 bridges were affected, including the Bay Bridge. A 76 by 50 foot or 23 by 15 meter section of the bridge's upper deck on the eastern side snapped and fell onto the deck below. It claimed one of the 63 total lives lost during the earthquake. Just imagine, a staggering 50-foot chunk of the Bay Bridge's upper deck collapsed as 2 million pounds of thrust caused the frame to shift 7 inches, shearing off bolts that connected the deck to the supports. It was a stark reminder just how vulnerable this aging giant had become. But this was nothing new to the officials of the California Department of Transportation, or Caltrans, which had been raising alarms about the bridge's crack-susceptible eyebar design for years. The earthquake turned those whispers into a deafening roar. The Loma Prieta earthquake underscored a critical truth. The Bay Area's bridges had to be rebuilt to withstand earthquakes that could strike at any moment. With a 70% probability of a major quake happening in the next 30 years, the stakes were high. If a 6.9 magnitude earthquake could do that much damage, what would happen if one the magnitude of the San Francisco quake of 1906, which hit 7.8 on the Richter scale, struck? Given that the Bay Bridge had historically struggled with seismic threats, it undeniably became a ticking time bomb. So, Caltrans sprang into action. The agency had a straightforward mission: to replace the eastern span with a new bridge that met modern seismic and safety standards. The Caltrans officials needed something that could sustain an 8.5 magnitude quake, and they were determined to make it happen. But you can't just close a bridge that carries over a quarter of a million commuters every single day between Oakland and San Francisco. That's a logistical nightmare waiting to happen. So they came up with an audacious plan: build a new bridge and destroy the old one, all the while keeping the traffic flowing. It was a plan that called for precise statistical planning. First, the corridor schedule team was born, tasked with monitoring the progress of a whopping 21 contracts. Managing a project of this scale required serious coordination. Every contract had to be analyzed for potential risks. If one aspect was accelerated, would it affect another? What were the costs? The effects on schedules? The team had its work cut out for them. But they managed to keep the traffic flowing. To accomplish this massive undertaking, two innovative detours were introduced: the Yerba Buena Island Detour and the Oakland Touchdown Detour. The Yerba Buena Island Detour played a critical role. It rerouted traffic off the old roadway, allowing construction crews to demolish the aging spans and build new transition structures right on the island as they installed the new self-anchored suspension, or SAS, spans. Thanks to this strategic maneuver, Caltrans not only kept the project moving, but even stayed ahead of schedule, a rare feat in massive infrastructure projects. It was a masterclass in logistics. But there was still a monumental task ahead. After all, we're talking about the largest bridge project in California's history and one of the preeminent engineering feats of the 20th century. For this project, every step had to be meticulously planned and executed to successfully transform a vital transportation artery while keeping the Bay Area moving. It was a feat that demanded not just ingenuity, but also precise coordination. At its tallest point, the bridge stood 135 feet above water, tapering down to 40 feet as it reached the shore. Each span needed to be angled just right as it approached the land, all while factoring in the unpredictable tidal changes and weather conditions of the bay. Plus, time was a major factor. Every bridge segment had to be removed between November and April to avoid interfering with migratory birds returning to nest. This only added to the sense of urgency. But perhaps the most formidable challenge lay in the engineering of the central anchorage, which required sinking 265 feet or 80 meters below the water to reach solid bedrock. This monumental task used a multiple-dome caisson, a brilliant invention that showcased the innovative spirit driving this project. And if you thought accessing the necessary construction sites was straightforward, think again. Caltrans faced a year-long struggle to get permission from the Navy to even conduct geological testing on Yerba Buena Island, leading to significant delays and rising costs. But these costs were nothing new. Initially, the plan was to retrofit the existing eastern span, estimated to cost approximately $200 million. However, further engineering assessments revealed that building a new bridge would cost a few hundred million more, but yield a much longer lifespan, 75 to 100 years versus a mere 30 years for the retrofit. But that wasn't the end of the road. The aesthetics of the initial design, often criticized as a freeway on stilts, sparked significant pushback from the public and local politicians. To address these concerns, a dedicated design team set out to choose a signature span that would be both functional and visually iconic. Yet, the process was anything but smooth. Conflicts arose within the engineering and design advisory panel, especially as panel members faced the challenge of evaluating proposals from their own firms. And of course, the problems would only continue to pile up once the construction of the new bridge actually started. But each time, the team found a way to adapt and innovate. The construction of the new SAS bridge kicked off with the Skyway section in 2002. This impressive stretch spanned 1.2 miles from the Oakland touchdown structures to the SAS span. This impressive stretch spanned 1.2 miles from the Oakland touchdown structures to the SAS span. Pile driving began in February of 2003, and by 2007, the Skyway was 75% complete. But this doesn't mean the first few years were problem-free. In 2005 alone, there were two notable interruptions to the process. The first was caused by the then-governor of California, Arnold Schwarzenegger, who proposed a redesign for the SAS bridge itself. The proposal faced intense scrutiny, with a report warning of severe time and cost overruns. The same year, the FBI began to investigate allegations that welders were cutting corners in their work, which threatened the structural integrity of the new span. However, in a twist, the FBI closed the investigation, revealing that critical welds were actually 30% stronger than required. The entire Skyway project was officially wrapped by 2016. But how did they make it happen? The construction techniques were nothing short of genius. The team drove large diameter tubular piles at angles due to weak soil conditions and barged in precast segments that were assembled using cantilever lifts. Now, let's talk about the star of the show, the SAS bridge itself. It boasted a unique self-anchored suspension design, with a single asymmetrical tower tailored for the site's specific challenges. Construction on this main span began in 2008, featuring a main cable designed as a single loop, giving it the ability to sustain higher traffic volumes. In addition, the bridge's seismic design was top-notch, with energy-absorbing features that made it tough enough to withstand severe earthquakes. Thus, the original goal of the project was achieved. The tower construction started in 2010, and it went through multiple phases. On July of 28th that year, the team erected the first of four below-deck main tower pillars. By March of 2011, the tower stood tall at 480 feet, and by December 2011, it was complete. This also meant that cable installation could finally begin. The team used prefabricated mile-long cable bundles for efficiency instead of the traditional one-wire-at-a-time method. In total, 137 cable bundles were meticulously installed. By late May of 2012, the entire cable was being compressed into a sleek, circular shape and wrapped in a protective wire jacket. It truly was a sight to behold. Tensioning was performed individually on each suspender cable to evenly distribute the load, culminating on November 20th, 2012, when the SAS section became self-supporting. Meanwhile, the Oakland touchdown phase kicked off in 2009 and was completed in 2013. It focused on getting the eastbound traffic side finished by May of 2011. This involved crafting a curved elevated roadway linked to the existing road, completed in two phases to keep traffic flowing. By mid-March of 2013, the western portion was finished and the construction catwalks were removed, making way for the grand reveal. But what about the old eastern span? It began its slow farewell in January of 2012, with demolition estimates suggesting it would take a staggering 5 to 7 years to complete and cost. It began its slow farewell in January of 2012, with demolition estimates suggesting that it would take a staggering 5 to 7 years to complete and cost around $244 million. It was a high price tag to simply get rid of something. Over 8,000 workers built the original bridge, but the demolition was tackled by a lean crew of about 34-person teams. These workers, part of the CEC Silverado joint venture, handled the task like the seasoned pros they were. They were suspended 200 feet above the San Francisco Bay in manlift baskets. They expertly cut the bridge apart with torches while crane operators skillfully maneuvered the steel. But it wasn't until January 28, 2014 that things got serious. Giant red jackhammers pounded away, making the old span shudder and vibrate. For months, commuters, cyclists, and runners all watched the dramatic transformation unfold. By June of 2015, the monumental cantilever section was officially done. Crews meticulously dismantled the structure in reverse order from how it was assembled back in the 1930s. This wasn't just any teardown. It involved high-wire acts, literally, while adhering to strict environmental safeguards. Still, everything went off without a hitch. Brian Maroney, the chief bridge engineer, noted the old steel was tired and cracked, but the demolition was completed on time, under budget, and without any accidents. By the end of 2015, phase one of the demolition process wrapped, marking the removal of the entire cantilever section and the S-curve. Two teams worked tirelessly on the suspended bridge while a third tackled the S-curve, a tricky detour to the Yerba Buena tunnel. Removal of the S-curve was no easy feat, given its proximity to the new bridge and live traffic. But thanks to the use of 42-inch diameter false work, originally intended for the new Bay Bridge, the crew navigated the demolition relatively easily. Phase 2 targeted the removal of the colossal 1.7 million pound truss sections. This phase required not just strength, but also precise planning and coordination. As the old East Span was dismantled, crews loaded materials onto barges for recycling. The use of the Enerpac hydraulic jackup system was a game changer for lifting the truss sections. The multi-point lifting system featured four jackup towers under each corner of a load, providing stability and speed. With a lift capacity ranging from 125 to 750 tons, this tech slashed the time needed for each span removal. The teams were able to cut the span removal from 6 weeks to around 1 week per span. But the demolition wasn't without its unusual problems. On November 11th, 2017, some of the final remnants of the old bridge were set to be removed. But as the crews worked to demolish the marine foundations, they encountered a surprise visitor. A seal had wandered into the exclusion zone, causing a brief delay. Marine mammal watchers were brought on site to ensure safety protocols for the relocation of the seals were followed. Once the coast was clear, the final implosion went off without a hitch. In total, over 58,200 tons of steel and around 245,000 tons of concrete from the old Eastern Span were removed. On September 8, 2018, a series of controlled implosions marked the final act in the demolition saga of the Old Bay Bridge. The last remnants, Pier E-19 and Pier E-20, were removed from San Francisco Bay, officially ending a remarkable transformation that began with the construction of the new span between 2002 and 2013. In the early stages of the construction, Kenneth Terpstra of Caltrans said, "When this project opens to the public, they will be awed by what they behold." And that's precisely what happened. Since its completion, the Bay Bridge has flourished, accommodating increasing traffic with grace and reliability. As commuters enjoy the smoother ride and breathtaking views, the bridge stands as a testament to human ingenuity and collaboration, paving the way for a brighter, safer future. And it was all done without even stopping traffic. So there you have it, the tale of the efficient removal of the longest US bridge span in history, making way for something even greater. What do you think of this remarkable undertaking? Share your thoughts in the comments section below, and as always, thanks for watching and take care out there.